show tonight begins on a cool autumn night, circa October 1984. A day that most would say greatness was truly born. And as I entered this world, I saw the nurses scurrying about. And I think to myself, man, I must be pretty good. However, I see my father faint. My curiosity begins to rise. But before I could have a chance to understand what was going on, I hear a sudden crying emanating from behind me. And of course you can imagine my confusion for the mere fact that my mother did not know she was having twins. But as I turn and I see his smiling face looking back at me, it's the same smiling face I see 29 years later. And Brendan, I can say to you today, May 10th, 2014, no give backs. But in living with John for those 29 years, I've really been able to learn about him, learn what makes him tick. For instance, I've learned John's workday does not, under any circumstances, come hell or high water, start before 10:30 in the morning. That John's cell phone is nothing more than a mere paperweight, as he has yet to understand that he can make or receive phone calls. That the modern day invention of a hairbrush eludes him until his very day. But more importantly, John is not the Casanova that he sees himself as being. See, John, Brittany, and I have lived together for the past couple of years. And during that time, my day involved things that you would expect living with a new relationship. Terms of endearment, pet nicknames. But there was two sayings that were repeatedly said that stand out with me the most. John looking at Brittany, Brittany, do you know how lucky you are? All of this is yours for the rest of your life. Now, I personally thought cruel and unusual punishment was illegal in the United States. Second saying, John again looking at Brittany. Brittany, I'm astounded. Brittany has to run. Now, see, I tell you these stories because I'm telling you something now that I'm not supposed to tell you, but I'll tell you anyway. The first time I met Brittany was here in Avalon. And as I woke that morning, John scurrying around downstairs, cleaning his room, taking a shower, doing his hair without a hairbrush. I walk out on the deck. Brittany getting out of her car. First time I meet her, I yell from the deck, hey, look, everyone. It's John's fiance. Brittany's face turns as red as the stop sign at the end of the street. She retreats to her car and call her mother, saying, I don't know if I can do this. She regains her composure after Lois talks her down, and she comes inside. And the conversation is what one could expect, meeting a significant other's family for the first time. A mom, a dad, an identical twin brother with absolutely zero boundaries. So as Brittany gains her composure, she comes down, we have a good time. But we decide to take her to a party, and a very good friend of ours, Matteo's, a couple doors down. Woo! And at that party, amongst family and friends, I decided it would be an appropriate time to say, Mom, Dad, what's the sleeping arrangements for these two? Brittany's face turned about four shades darker than the aforementioned stop sign. She's gazing over the deck railing as if to ponder with the height of the fall could be serious injuries. It was at that time I knew if she made it through that weekend with me, that she'd be allowed around for a long time. It's something I would not trade for anything in this world. John's an absolutely amazing brother, but he's a better best friend. He's a man of moral character, and he's always been there for me no matter what. Aww. Very difficult for someone to measure up to my expectations of what John deserved. And by meeting Brittany, I knew that you not only met those expectations, Brittany, but you exceeded them. You're an absolutely amazing person, and John's so lucky to have you. Guys, I just want to wish you the best of luck, and I love you both.